In silence bound, wandering the mortal's plain, crossing a wide expanse of brilliant peace. Narad, the heavenly sage from paradise, came chanting through the large and lustrous air. As might a lightning streak, a glory fell, nearing until the rapt eyes of the sage looked out from luminous cloud and strangely limbed, his face a beautiful mask of antique joy, appearing in light, descended where rose King Ashwapati's palace to the winds in Madra, flowering up in delicate stone. There welcomed him the sage and thoughtful king. At his side, a creature beautiful, passionate, wise, aspiring like a sacrificial flame, skyward from its earth seat through luminous air. Queen Brahm, the human mother of Savitri. He sang to them of the lotus heart of love, with all its thousand luminous buds of truth, which, quivering, sleeps veiled by apparent things.
Ravishing flutes of heaven have
shrill, high melodies round from near and far, approaching through the soft and reveling air, which still surprised their hearing. They have fed thy silence on some red, strange ecstasy's fruit, and thou hast trod the dim moon peaks of bliss. Reveal, O winged with light, whence thou hast flown, hastening bright hued through the green tangled earth. Thy body rhythmical with spring bird's call. But Aswapati answered to the seer, as grows the great and golden bounteous tree, flowering by Alakananda's murmuring way, where with enamored speed the waters run, lisping and babbling to the splendor of morn, and cling with lyric laughter round the knees of heaven's daughters, dripping magic rain, pearl bright from moon gold limbs and cloudy hair, so are her dawns like jeweled gleams of light. So cast she her felicity on men. Virgin, who comest perfected by joy, reveal the name thy sudden heartbeats blurt. Whom hast thou chosen kingliest among men? And Savitri answered with her still calm voice, as one who speaks beneath the eyes of fate, Father and King, I have carried out thy will. One whom I sought, I found in distant lands. I have obeyed my heart, I have heard its call. My Father, I have chosen. This is done. Astonished, all sat silent for a space. Then Aswapati looked within and saw a heavy shadow float above the name, chased by a sudden and stupendous light. But now the queen, alarmed, lifted her voice. O seer, thy bright arrival has been timed. To this high moment of a happy life, hide not from us our doom, if doom is ours. This is the worst and unknown face of fate, a terror ominous, mute, felt more than seen. Behind our seat by day, our couch by night, a fate lurking in the shadow of our hearts. The anguish of the unseen that waits to strike. To know is best, however hard to bear. Then cried the sage, piercing the mother's heart, forcing to steal the will of Savitri. His words set free the spring of cosmic fate. The truth thou hast to claim, I give to thee the truth. Heaven's greatness came, but was too great to stay. 12 swift-winged months are given to him and her. This day returning, Satyavan must die. But the queen cried, vain then can be heaven's grace. Mounting thy car, go forth, O Savitri, and travel once more through the peopled land. Plead not thy choice, for death has made it vain. But Savitri answered from her violent heart, once my heart chose and chooses not again, the word I have spoken can never be erased. It is written in the record book of God. O child, in the magnificence of thy soul, dwelling on the border of a greater world, and dazzled by thy superhuman thought, thou lent eternity to immortal hope. But Savitri replied with steadfast eyes, if for a year, that year is all my life. And yet I know this is not all my fate. Only to live and love a while and die. For I know now why my spirit came on earth, and who I am, and who is I love. I have looked at him from my immortal self. I have seen God smile at me in Satyavana. I have seen the Eternal in a human face.